So for optical fibers, we'll be having two lectures of theory and 2 hours dedicated for your practicals. For practical, I'll be using LabVIEW, which has a provision of both simulation using your not only the this equipments also. So we'll be using LabVIEW for that, and you will have a 25 marks internal assessment, 75 marks NSEM evaluation, 25 marks practical, and 25 marks term work. The 6 modules that I'll be covering in this will be, first is an optical fiber. So in our first chapter of optical fiber and their properties, we will be looking into the development of optical communication. How did it come into existence? Was it new concept, or were we very much aware of it, and what was stopping us to use it for commercial communication? Its advantages and disadvantages, its comparison with the already existing systems. You have already studied about satellite communication, so we'll be just having an comparison of this communication and optical, which one is better, or do we want both to support a good communication system. And classification of fiber, how do we classify it? How does a signal travel through a fiber? That is a basic working principle. And depending upon the bandwidth, number of signals, and how the signal will be, the fibers will be classified, that is taken care in chapter number 1. Chapter number 2 is about various components to make a simple fiber optic communication link. So it will start with simple fiber fabrication techniques, then the components like joints, connectors, splicers, couplers, multiplexers, gratings, filters, switches, converters, your amplifiers. All this will be taken except 2 components that will be left is the optical sources and detector, because we have 2 separate chapters dedicated for optical sources and detectors, that is chapter number 3 and chapter number 5. So they are basically, will be more focusing on the LEDs and the lasers and the quantum well lasers. That's what we'll be focusing on, because LED is what you are already aware with. The configuration is not different, only how we are using, or whether it's in forward bias, reverse bias, working principle, how the efficiency of a device is increased. So numericals are also there in your optical sources and detector, that is 3 and 5, which are nothing but the part of chapter number 2 only, the components. Then comes this chapter number 4, which is about when a signal is traveling. Definitely the objective of any signal transmission is to have a high signal to noise ratio, and therefore while calculating what are the sources of noise or signal attenuation, we need to understand what are the points where the signal will deteriorate or get lost. So transmission characteristics of an optical fiber talks about attenuation as well as dispersion, and linear dispersion and the non-linear dispersion, along with how these losses, attenuation and dispersion can be measured, and instrument that is used in field for optical fiber communication to detect these losses is optical time domain reflectometer, that is OTDR, that we'll be taking understanding in chapter number 4. And chapter number 6 is about your formation of a link. As we have already done the link budgeting in satellite communication, similarly we have a link optical link budgeting with respect to power budget and the rise time budget. Power budget is about how much power that should be transmitted in an optical fiber, because we know that the power that is being transmitted to an optical fiber is very low, and it, because higher is the optical power, it results in the losses and attenuation of the signal. And the Reichstam budget is about the actual bandwidth that is available for use for sending the user data. So the system components are the are actually giving you or limiting the bandwidth, so that we need to study in this optical link. So it is similar to what we did about various power losses, power being transmitted. Only thing is here we need to consider the components, because there it was a free space and now it is a medium through which the signal is being transmitted, that is a fiber. So the books that I refer for teaching this subject is Senior and Kaiser. These two are the books that I use for teaching the subject. Columbaris is used only for your components part, that is your lasers and the detectors. These are quantum well part is devices you will find more nicely given in Columbaris. And this Palace will give you numericals, and only the transmission, there is a non-linear part of cross-phase modulation four-wave. Although it is nicely given in Kaiser also, you find this part explained in Ghatak and this Introduction to Fiber Optics, this fifth book. But I prefer these two books, and this only for the components. Numericals definitely for more practice, because this book has lot of numericals. 60-70 numericals are there in this book Palace, which is there definitely in our library. I'll see if I have the soft copy, I'll share, but I don't think it's easily available, this Palace. Kaiser ka to soft copy mil jayega, Senior ka bhi aapko easily e-book mil jata hai. Kaiser, I may have, I can share it with you. There are certain courses on NPTEL also. Those who are interested can join this optical communication course. It's running now on NPTEL. They can join this optical communication course. And one more branch that you may find interesting to learn along with this is the effect of light on the semiconductors. That is also one course I found on NPTEL, that is on photonics, solar cells and photonics. So it's a related topic, but it takes into consideration more of your devices concept and the effect of light on this semiconductors. But directly you will find this optical communication course available on NPTEL. So those who are interested can join that course. The practical list is not included here, so that definitely I'll share as we progress, because this is first time I'm introducing LabVIEW, because I found it very interesting. And there are a lot of things. Basically, you don't look it only from an experiment point of view or simple writing. Because previously, when I started, I only designed this lab that was in Scilab. So that was all numericals, or basically it was the way we did it for SATCOM. It was all numericals and those we were solving. So it was like characteristic plotting. Basically in optical, it was not numericals, but it was the characteristics plotting of the single mode fibers, say, or the sources or a detector, or finding the numerical aperture efficiency. All these were like basically the model equations we had, and we could get the characteristics. But this LabVIEW will give us a better understanding of, when I say link budgeting and other things, we'll be able to do it. So I hope that may add value to your knowledge and your ability to do your projects also more. So to start with, so can you share me what do you think, what is an optical communication? PPT is not visible. Okay, I'll stop share and share again. Yeah, is my PPT now visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now tell me, what do you understand by optical communication? You have already studied satellite communication. So what are your thoughts? What is an optical communication? Communication with light, very good. What else? So what is light in this communication? Can you tell me? Communication with light, definitely it's correct. But what is light in this? Communication takes place through reflections of light. Not exactly reflections of light. The word communication with light is correct, but I want to understand, what is this light working in this communication or acting like? Reflections and refractions, yes. Photons. What else? Data transmission. Light is an electromagnetic in nature, yes. So it's an electromagnetic wave transmission, right? So it's nothing similar. It's similar to your any electromagnetic wave transmission. It's light acts as a carrier, right? What is light in optical communication? Light is a carrier. It's a high frequency carrier, and the light that is used for optical communication is the infrared light, near infrared light that we used for optical communication. Now my question comes is, were we using light as a communication or did we start using this light as for communication recently, or was it being used long back also by our ancestors or people who actually did not had any other medium for communication? Were they using lights also? Yes or no? Can anyone give me one example for signals? Yes, Vivek, how for signals, what kind of signals they were sending?
Red colored light was used to indicate danger.
Okay, correct. So the colors of the light, right? So what does the color represent? Correct. Mirrors, right? Reflection. Vivian. The light was falling. What did you say, Vivek? Signals means?
Vivian.
Correct. Very good. So different colors were, that means you were sending the information. Initially the light was used, different colors, to indicate a different information, that is red, as he said, about danger and other things. And different colors means different wavelengths. So it was, we were already aware that different wavelengths could be used for transmitting different signal, but what we were limited to, we were limited to only the visible light, correct? So visible light hone ke karan, as you said, mirrors, definitely the mirrors were used, that you were using mirrors reflection ke liye. Bachpan mein hum khelte the na, that friends at different corners sending, one was taking the sunlight, reflecting, all that kind of games. So again, similarly, that kind of reflector systems could be used to communicate the signal in the form of light. They also use reflection of the light, that is mirrors, correctly said. And also you must be aware, we all have seen some kind of tribal movies or others, smoke is used for communication, fire is used for communication. So all these are optical communication, because light is being used to communicate the information. Now point is, why we could not continue with that form of communication? Can anyone tell me? Ki hamare pas hum to kar hi rahe the na, we were using smoke, we were using fire, we were using different color of light, but why did it came into a communication which needed a cable? That is what I want to understand. Can anyone tell? That was a visible light that we were using. Privacy issues. Okay, so privacy is, yes, we'll come to it. Privacy comes when, you see, privacy comes when your data is very crucial or not possible for a long distance communication, correct? Not used for possible for long distance communication. It was a visible light, so only you could communicate to a shorter distance. And the second and the most important is since you were using the free space and visible light. Visible light was what you had, was you could send a limited information. Fire tha to smoke pe ek information jayega, fire pe ek other information. So since we were using visible light and only different colors could be used for say 1 second, third and fourth information, so there was a limitation to it, that we could not send much information when we were using these mediums. Secondly, during fog say, or during rainy day and such kind of conditions, definitely since it's a visible light being used, that is seen and that can be seen, it was we were not able to communicate all the time. So it was actually in a very limited information, you can say, we could transmit through the visible light communication system that you were using. So we will just see as how slowly this optical communication, all of us right now understand optical communication means using light for communication. And what is light there? It's a carrier, right? It's a carrier that is being sent. But previously what we were using traditionally, light was only to send a limited information. Maybe a fire at this point could be telling that the enemy is approaching, or smoke could be up. That this particular area has been taken over by the enemy. So that kind of important informations could be sent, but only limited information. So to start with, so this is 1972. Semaphore is a device that you see here. This is a semaphore that it had three arms, right? One, two, and three arms, which were flexible and which could be moving, which were placed at a tower, and it was used during the war times to send us information from this tower to say a distant tower, definitely using this free space. So now, as I said, you had a limited because you were using fire and smoke, so limited information. But with this semaphore, that is the first formal form of optical communication, was the semaphore in 1792, made in France. I don't remember the name of that person. Clad was the name of that person. And this was called as optical telegraph. And the different positions of these three arms was communicating a different alphabet, and therefore it could be used for sending the information from this tower to a tower about the various activities of the enemies. And that is how it was being used. Again, I said the limitation of this was, since free space was used and visible light was used to see what was being transmitted. And as you can see, there is a binocular in the hand of the person. When they are communicating from this end, what the other person is communicating, they are able to see. And but during rainy season, during clouds, they see when the light is less, or during the fog, what was happening was you were not able to communicate even in the case of emergency. Okay, so with these three arms, they could make say 26 alphabets, 1 ampersand, and your 10 digits that could be formed, and that the information could be sent. Then in 1870, the next that is a very crucial thing for an optical communication was John Tyndall gave a demonstration. We all knew that light travels in a straight line. Okay, so he gave a demonstration by putting in, I'll show you the video also of this demonstration. In a tub, he had a outlet, and in this he kept a very a dense liquid in it, and when the sunlight was falling from it, it was through this liquid which was flowing, the sunlight could reach this point following the path defined by the liquid flow. That was a denser liquid, and there was a interface of light and liquid and the air, and this light was traveling through it, but to a certain distance it could travel and then it was getting lost. So for this demonstration, I just want to show you a video to have a better understanding. Yeah, is the screen visible? Just tell me something.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
So I find this a fascinating object. It's a fiber optic cable for a stereo. If I shine this laser pointer down the cable, it guides the light out the other end. These cables are used to connect our world today and are capable of transmitting information across countries and oceans. But first, let me show you how it works. I have a bucket that I've modified with a window in front. And on the other side, I put a stopper in this hole right here. I have a bottle of propylene glycol with just a little bit of creamer in it. A ring stand. And of course, a laser pointer. Now, keep your eye on this plug when I turn off the lights. That's wonderful. The light follows the liquid flow all the way to the bucket. Amazing. It does this because of total internal reflection. As the light enters the stream, it is reflected as soon as it hits the interface between air and liquid. You can see here the first reflection, and then the second, and the third. This occurs because there's a difference between the index of refraction of the guide material, here propylene glycol, and the outside, air in this case.
So could you see the experiment that he performed and how he could see that the light is not, it does not necessary that the light will travel in a straight path to reach any point. You could actually bend the light and make it reach some other point. Okay, so that was actually the first time you can say that it was seen how the light could be used for transmission over a distance, which was not a straight line. And the total internal reflection concept came into understanding that there was a possibility that you could use this concept to guide the light. And that is your basic principle for optical communication signal transmission. The whole signal transmission in an optical fiber takes place because of a principle, total internal reflection. In 1880, the next development that took place was in 1880, it was Alexander Graham Bell made a photophone. That is, with this device, if you see this setup, in this setup you can see the signal being transmitted, there is a mirror. So what was done was, at this point, this device that was used, you had the signal, voice signal being transmitted, and it was hitting the mirror, and because of the voice signal, the vibrations were created, which was on the mirror, right? And then when the sunlight was coming and striking on this mirror, these vibrations were actually superimposed on the sunlight, and because of the mirror, it was reflected back to the point or the device which was used for receiving the signal, and you could convert it back into the sound. This was the first time you can say that the signal transmission took place through an optical communication. The sunlight, which was actually having all the vibrations, which means whatever you said, that definitely we all of us understand, the vibrations are produced. That vibrations were actually getting superimposed on the sunlight, and because of this setup that it had, it came back to the receiver point and it could be again converted or received in the form of a sound. So that was that was again a big development that took place in the field of optical communication, that yes, the light could be used for sending an optical communication. Then in 1951, basically what happened was, we could understand that the signal could be transmitted through the light, but we all understood that there were losses when light was being transmitted through the free space, and definitely there is a need of a medium. So this team of Brian and Abraham and Harald, this all were working separately, and what they found was, it was easy to guide the light through a glass which had a refractive index higher than a coating which was covering it. That is, the concept of cladding came into existence. What is an optical fiber made up of? It has got a core, that is a center part through which the light travels, and there is always another coating of a material which has a refractive index lower than that of a core. So this team came up with the concept that if you have a cladding over it, it will allow the light to travel through a long distance because the losses are reduced because of refraction and interference. So basically they talked about the losses getting reduced because of interference when this cladding was there. Then later, Lawrence came up with how this cladding can be made with the glass material. So core is also made of a glass, and the cladding with certain impurities added, it will reduce its refractive index. So this core cladding combination will be, and basically practically he brought out that core cladding fibers into existence. Dr. Kayo, he is said to be the father of optical communication, because he brought out all the theoretical concepts of how the signal can travel through an optical fiber with which has the fibers which have an attenuation of less than 20 dB per kilometer, right? This term, the through his theoretical studies or in the laboratory experiments at Bell Labs, he came out with the concept that in 1966 he brought out this concept that these fibers can be used for commercial communication if the losses could be reduced to 20 dB per kilometer, and which was very much appreciated by British Post Office for using this medium for the signal transmission. Then this was theoretically in the laboratory that he proved, and this is a team of Donald, Robert and Peter at Corning, who were the first to bring out the fibers or make the fibers with as In 1960, Kayo gave us the concept that the fiber should have an attenuation less than 17 dB per kilometer, 20 dB per kilometer. And in 1966, this team made a fiber which had an attenuation as low as 17 dB per kilometer. And that is when the optical fibers came into commercial use. Before that, the attenuation was so high and it was actually not coming into commercial use because of the various limitations. This team came out with the fibers, and that is how this optical fibers came into existence for commercial communication. Okay, so any doubt in this? So how optical fiber came into communication from a visible... from a visible medium, light being used to, right, So no doubt. So visible light being used through a free space to a guided medium, right? So guided medium could be used for long distance communication, that was proved. Then the light could be used for any signal transmission. So voice signal was demonstrated by Graham Bell. And then it was found that when we are using a medium, the losses could be reduced, interferences could be reduced if we could add a cladding. Then practically that cladding, core cladding fiber concept came into existence. And then it was found that the losses were very high and still it could not be used for commercial use till we came out with the fibers with losses as low as 17 dB. And then this optical fibers came into commercial use. Okay. Yes. So now I'll just first show you one video. The importance of optical communication, and then we'll start with the optical.
Let's look at how fiber optic communications connects the world.
Voice is there? This video and voice are visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Photograph, a composite photograph made by NASA from the International Space Station, shows lights from all the great cities in the world. Here you can see where people live and work around our Earth. If we overlay that photograph with a map of all the undersea fiber optic cables that are currently in operation, you can see how fiber optics connects all the centers of civilization around the Earth. Today, virtually all communications travel on fiber optics. Why is that? This photograph, taken by AT&T in the mid-1970s, before fiber was actually used very much, shows the difference. That single optical fiber can carry many times more communication signals than that giant copper cable. It costs less, the signals carry much further, 1,000 times further, and the amount of signals that can be carried on the optical fiber is almost limitless. Thus, fiber has become the real choice for communications. Today, fiber is used everywhere, in telecommunications, for telephones, the internet, even fiber to the home, and believe it or not, wireless. It isn't wireless, it's connected with fiber. Fiber is used in computer networks and data centers that store the data that is requested on the internet. Cable TV uses fiber optics for video as well as voice and internet. Utilities use fiber for their own communications, but for the management of their power grid. Security systems use fiber for surveillance cameras and intrusion sensors. Entertainment, lots of entertainment systems use fiber. You wouldn't believe where it's used every day. Intelligent highways use fiber. The military uses fiber. Fiber is everywhere. Telecommunications fiber replaces copper or radio links. It uses all digital transmission and has replaced all long distance links, most metropolitan links in cities, and is even now being used to connect fiber to the home using passive optical networks. Worldwide, all fiber used is basically using the same state-of-the-art technology. The photograph here shows three fiber optic cables joined outside the entrance to the archaeological dig of the ancient city of Troy in Turkey. Fiber is used in wireless communications for cellular antennas, wireless LANs for Wi-Fi and WiMAX, the Earthlinks for satellites, and all of these are connected into worldwide networks on fiber.
your typical cellular phone antenna looks like one of these on these towers. The connections to the towers from the phone system is done on optical fiber. And now, with so many antennas being used on the towers, the coaxial cable that's traditionally been used for them is too heavy. So now they're using fiber up the towers. Fiber is even used to directly connect homes now. New technology makes it cost effective, and it allows gigabit speeds straight to the home, the kind of speeds that are necessary for advanced video and internet services. Cable TV systems have been using hybrid fiber coax networks since the mid-90s. The systems actually work on analog signals, simply converting the standard telephone analog signal to an optical signal and communicating over single mode optical fiber. They overbuild on the coax by actually lashing the fiber usually to the aerial coax or pulling it underground with it. It's very easy to even extend fiber to the home on a cable TV system using their own version of passive optical networks called RFOG or RF over glass. If you've seen big screen televisions at sporting events or in areas like the casinos or in Las Vegas or concert halls, those big screen televisions are typically connected on optical fiber. You can see the picture on the large screen television in the upper right-hand corner of the slide with a cameraman in front. The camera is connected on fiber, the screen is connected on fiber, as they are showing a sports car race through the streets of Long Beach. Below that, you can see a giant screen on the strip in Las Vegas, also connected on fiber. Many security systems depend on fiber because cameras, surveillance cameras, are often far away from the monitoring points. So closed circuit TV and intrusion sensors are connected on optical fiber. For those cameras that you see in even the roofs or ceilings of banks, on light poles around cities, and in tunnels. One of the more exciting uses of fiber optics goes back to 1986, when Dr. Ballard at Woods Hole Oceanographic upgraded JASON, their remote piloted vehicle, with optical fiber. So instead of only being able to go a few thousand feet underwater, he can go all the way down 12,000 feet to take pictures of the Titanic. Woods Hole just made another expedition to the Titanic in October of 2010, using more advanced cameras to do 3D pictures of the Titanic. Local area networks use fiber too. Typically, the backbone of local area networks is on fiber because those backbones can run 10 gigabits per second. Sometimes fiber is used all the way to the desktop and to connect up wireless access points. In most networks now, they seem to be migrating toward fiber backbones, wireless access points, and very little direct cable connection to the desktop because users want mobility. They want their Wi-Fi connected laptops to be able to work anywhere within a building or on a campus. Data centers are where all the data is stored for internet, websites, email, you name it. The internet is very, very fast. Of course, it's all on fiber. And there's so much data being transferred that these data centers require the fastest possible cabling connections you can imagine. Fiber is really the most cost-effective method for connecting servers to storage in data centers. A big advantage is fiber uses only 20% as much power as a Category 6 link. So data centers cabled with fiber use much less power and require much less air conditioning. That makes them cheaper. Fiber is used in many industrial applications also. Because fiber is all glass, it's immune to electrical noise. It's also more flexible than copper and can withstand high temperatures. So applications like this welding robot here, shown welding the chassis of a car, can use fiber all the way down the arm, right to the welding head, in order to monitor and provide data for the systems. Fiber is even being proposed for board-level interconnects on high-speed computers, not just supercomputers, but most computers like servers and high-speed PCs. Copper uses too much power when it has to transmit fast signals. Fiber is faster and has much lower power consumption. Intel is one of the companies promoting this use. Electrical utilities have been using fiber for many years. They need lots of telecommunications over their networks, and they also monitor their networks and control the distribution of power. The new systems, which we call smart grid, which are getting even more sophisticated, require fiber from all stations back to a central monitoring facility. Today, fiber is often run inside the electrical conductors using a system called optical power ground wire. Fibers are inside the metal tubes and conductors of high voltage lines. Alternative energy systems also need fiber. Wind and solar systems, for example, require precise control to manage the operation and the distribution of power. These systems are typically connected with fiber because they're in very, very large geographic areas. There is a solar heated generation station in the Mojave Desert, like the picture below, that has 750 miles of optical fiber connecting all of the reflectors and the generators. There are other applications of fiber optics for building management, heating and air conditioning, as well as security, traffic control, smart highways, even automotive networks. Tens of millions of cars have their systems controlled by microprocessors and talking to each other over optical fiber inside cars. Fiber is also used for lighting, for signs, for places like swimming pools, and in sensors, specifically for things like high voltage and current, for monitoring chemicals and use in hazardous environments. There's even more interesting applications of fiber optics. You can get underwater housings for cameras that use fiber. Fiber optic switches to control garbage disposals and sinks. Artwork designed using fiber for its visual impact. Interesting uses for lighting. But perhaps the most unusual one is you can buy your Rolls Royce with a Starfield ceiling that uses fiber optics. We're the Fiber Optic Association, the professional.
So this video gave you an elaborate understanding of what could be the application. We just talk about optical for communication. Communication is not limited to your voice, video or data transmission. It is many more things that are being done. And in as I was talking initially was, Will optical fiber communication replace other or other communication are sufficient? Why do we need optical fiber? The answer, as we could see in this video, is it's being used together with the wireless communication or your space communication. Everywhere it has got its application. Communication inside a vehicle or in a LAN network or a local area network, everywhere this communication helps us in communication. So we could see there is no field where optical communication is not used, and now we understand its importance. So you got an answer of why it is important to learn it, right? I hope all of you got this answer as why it is important. Then only it makes sense of learning the subject. So this video was an answer to why we should learn optical communication. And now I'll start with it. since I know it's your break time, I'll give you a break of 5 minutes. We'll start again at 11:10. Okay?